You know what, actually, this home logo actually kind of fits with this book as I talk about homeless families in America. So, continuing to read excerpts from this big book, we now move to page 74. And this is the beginning of chapter 5 and part 1 of the book. And it's titled, The Big Street. So let's do it. The Death of the Hired Man by Robert Frost is quoted in many essays on the homeless. Some of us may feel that we have heard too many times the words of the farmer talking to his wife. Home, he says, is a place where, when you have to go there, they have to take you in. His wife's words are more interesting, but less often quoted. I should have called it something you somehow haven't to deserve, so you don't have to deserve the home to get it. Public policy in the United States today does not accord with this idea. We do appear to feel a home must somehow be deserved or earned. We do seem to regard it as a gift of sorts, which now and then may be awarded for correct behavior. The consequent feeling voiced by many women I have met is that a home is something they must prove that they deserve, but they do not know how they can. How does a woman prove she is deserving? How can she expect that anybody will believe her? Can Rachel prove her children are deserving? She may try. Much of what she said to me is like a lawyer's brief on their behalf. They're innocent. They're pure. She has no reason to expect that her opinion of her children will be given a responsive hearing. This question of deserving safe accommodations, food, forgiveness, love, freedom from fear, comes up in every conversation. Those who live in the greatest darkness often are the least prepared to call themselves deserving, and the least equipped to offer arguments that may persuade us that they are. And I believe the next part... Oh, I just keep on going. Okay, so after I leave New York each time, I find my thoughts returning to the people I have met. I think most frequently of Rachel, and I wonder what will happen to her children. What if the city takes her kids? Several times in the subsequent weeks, I have the wish to call her. This is, of course, impossible. She has no phone. There are phone booths in the lobby, but you cannot call a phone booth and expect to get a message to a woman in a room on the sixth floor. Messages I've phoned to the hotel desk have not been delivered. Letters sent to the hotel are sometimes long delayed before they reach a resident. It's easier to reach a friend of mine in northern Haiti than to get a note to Angelina's mother. A month later, I return. I go through the same ritual once more. Wait for the guards, wait for the elevator, give up waiting for the elevator, climb six flights of stairs, knock at the door. The rooms appear exactly as they did before. Nothing is different, but there is more tension in the air. They charging me with being a bad mother. You can see the letter that I got. It's in the bureau in the other room. Angie has been arrested. Her brother Steven is arrested too, but for a different reason. Angie was caught stealing. I ask, what did she steal? They got arrested stealing food. They did it at the grocery. Why they do it? Rachel says it was her fault. I didn't get my check. Made some mistake. I was cut off. They was hungry. Told me they was going to giving somebody downstairs. Came back with the chicken. I say, where you get the chicken? They say, we was packing bags in A&P. I know they was lying, so I say, tell me the truth. She says, we stole it. Next time that they did it, they got caught. Steven, he got caught for something small. He tried to jump the turnstile in the subway because he didn't have the token that he needs to get to school. Jumping the subway stile is so common that it isn't treated as a serious offense. Transit police are often tolerant with the children. Stealing from supermarket is a different matter. What I have a very hard time keeping in my mind is that all these kids are really hungry, and that some of them are hungry almost all the time. An 8-year-old who lives in the hotel is sitting on the bed with Angelina. He tells me he panhandles when he's hungry. I ask him where. The street, he says. Which street? The big street, he replies. Rachel says that he means Broadway where it enters Herald Square. Even though I've seen this often, I want him to tell me just exactly how he goes about it. I ask him what he does. Does he walk up to someone and put out his hand? He tells me he cleans windows in the cars that stop for the red light on 32nd Street. If the driver's not annoyed or not afraid of him, he rolls down the window and hands him a coin. He says he does it at rush hour in the afternoon. How much can he earn? A couple of dollars. What do you do with it, I ask. Go to the store, buy some juice, loaf of bread, a quart of milk, give me a box of cereal. What kind of cereal? Cheerios, he says it with a smile. He's tiny, thin, has freckles, and a cough. He's a student in the third grade. Raisin is his sister. Where is Raisin? Raisin's got the measles. Children I meet like this are sometimes very shy at first, and answer only in these short staccato bursts. Then some kind of key is turned, and an unexpected little narrative pours forth. This man that I met on the street, he says he'll give me $20. He stops right there and waits for me to ask him something more, so I ask him, what's he give you $20 for? If I take down my pants. Right on the street? Yes, he says. Which street? The big street, he says again. I ask him, when? At 2 o'clock. 2 in the afternoon? No, when it's dark. What did you do? I ran away, came home and told my mother. Rachel says, he ain't got no right to be out in the street at 2 o'clock, but they do it. And it happens. It don't need to be at night. Angie and her friend be out there in the afternoon. Man come up, she doesn't understand that he's a pimp. He treats him to a meal. Why do they wanna feed a little girl? Fatten her up. Later he'll say, remember what I done? You owe me something in return. Angie says, they was grown up man. They told my friend, they said, your friend was pretty, so they say, do you want anything to eat? I was hungry. I said yes. They bought us hot dogs and a soda. So they said, meet us on Friday night. We'll take you to the movie. You don't need to bring your brother. I'm not stupid. I stayed home. I may be little, but I have a brain. Years ago, I was a grade school teacher and taught children just about her age. It's easy to imagine her surrounded by other children in the classroom of a cheerful, clean, suburban school. It would be fun to be her teacher. She's alert and funny, and the phrasing that she chooses is amusing. Even when the theme is human ruin, I enjoy her skipping moods, her merriment and whim. Does she know that she is telling me the story of her own demise? Sordid though the story, and disheartening and foul the foul walls of the surrounding room, she lives in the child's garden still. Innocent tonight, she may be transformed into a tough and lean and predatory woman in 2 years. Sitting here, it's easy to forget I'm not her teacher, and she'll never be a student in a good suburban school. One day, we were out in Herald Square. This old man, a white man, he said he was going to give me money. Gave me a $5 bill. Then he asked me was I hungry, and I was. So he says he's going to take me to Burger King. So I went with him, and we went to this parking lot, and he pulled down his drawers. So I came home. In the other bedroom later, with the door closed, Rachel tells me Angelina won't go outside any longer. She won't step outside that door. She's scared. She's even scared to go to school. The letter I got from BCW, Bureau of Child Welfare, I got it hidden here. The Bureau of Child Welfare has been renamed Special Services for Children. Most of the mothers still refer to it by its original initials. The letter from HRA caseworker is a warning that she's now under investigation. The letter includes a memo that refers to her abuse of alcohol. Would these kids be better off if they were taken from her? Knowing what I do of foster care in New York City, I'm certain that their lives would not be better. Even a home, sufficient food, a stove, a place to stay, a neighborhood, real education in small classes in a first-rate school, would any of this make a difference now? Is it too late? It is impossible to know, and their society, in any case, is not disposed to offer them this option. One thing I know, foster care cannot provide these children with the soaring royalty that Rachel feels, the love that makes her language incandescent when she speaks of Angelina. It's her solace, but because she cannot do what love instructs, it is her agony. Desire can be renounced, Ignatius writes, and wishes bleach the way. But the tragedy of need, the desperation of mother's love, is that it can neither be renounced nor patiently endured. I didn't tell you this before. Angie, when they caught her stealing at the store, they brought her in here with handcuffs. I don't think you need to do that to a child. Once you see that, it do make things different. You do see yourself somewhat different from before. Well, if I done that, if I be bad, then why not go and do some more? I never get to talk with her again. Someone has told her I have talked with the BCW. The next time she sees me in the lobby, she turns instantly and hurries towards the stairs. So, I really wanted to bring up this excerpt, not because it really paints a vivid picture, but because Rachel is talked about a lot in this book, and their children, you know, Angie and Steven, Angie who is caught for stealing food in the supermarket, you know, it's one powerful example of how kids, innocent as they may be, in this lifestyle, eventually, they turn into criminals. And in this one part of the book, there is a quote where Rachel says that they're not killers now, they never killed in their life, whatever. But she says that if they don't kill in this world, they won't survive.